Okay, Barend. Today we're going to talk about recruitment productivity. So when you're in sales, everybody knows Aaron Ross, and he has this. He wrote this book called Predictable Revenue, and he was able to come up with a model where the more expensive and skilled people would do low activity, high volume work, and the relatively junior and more affordable people in your team would do the high volume, low impact work. And he assembled a sales organization around that that also made Salesforce really successful. We now know this as the SDR AE setup. Then customer success management. But I think if you talk about recruiting and everything that's currently happening with the new AI technologies being available, we're approaching an era where we can do the same, apply those same models to recruiting, right?
Yeah, I think so. Because I think, as you just described it, in sales, you had this group of people that was junior, still needed to learn, couldn't close a full cycle. And I know what you say, like, and then when they start a career, you give them like the job to just do cold lead calling, calling people just 8 hours a day, creating leads. And then the more senior, expensive, experienced people take over and they close the deals in the sales process.
Yes.
Yeah. And I think in recruitment, that distinction never really happened. I think in recruitment, it was more like 360, right? People were responsible often for the full process. But now, and maybe that's also the parallel you're referring to, and I think you're right, now we have AI. So now we have a junior colleague that is cheaper and that can do repetitive work and doesn't mind, and that can make sure that the recruiters can spend time on the, what you call, I think, high-paying activities, things that actually make a difference in the recruitment process, right?
Yep. Yeah, I think the difference is that in recruit, so I think what we can do, if you look at recruiting now, you're right, especially in the agency world, it's usually a 360 role. Maybe you've outsourced some sourcing stuff, but in general, what we also see with clients is it's a 360 role. So you're responsible for the client, for the vacancy, and you're responsible for the sourcing, your own talent pool, and then the placement of it. And I'm sure many companies have tried different models. I think what we can do now is if you look at that more high volume, low value work in the beginning of your process, let's talk about sourcing or do data management, reaching out to candidates. That work had to be done by a human and was done by in this case, the same expensive and smart consultant that's probably best in just placing candidates. And now we can literally delegate those tasks to AI, making this very high valued person so much more productive than before.
Yeah. And I think it's even better because where you segment the process by humans, you have to have a clear starting and an end point, right? To hand over responsibilities. Now you talk about it, for me, it feels like you're going back even to the 50s or the 60s where every manager had a secretary and you don't have to delegate a full process. You can also just delegate annoying jobs, things that are, part of your process, but where you don't want to spend time on. And then, when you talk about recruitment, even the most seasoned senior recruiter that is really good in engaging with candidates, making perfect matches, selling a job to someone, still has to do admin tasks, for example.
Yeah.
And I think that's how you can look at the process now, not even breaking a process in half, just cherry picking. They are too expensive to do this stupid work. Let's give it to our new colleague, Mr. AI.
Yeah. Yeah, because to make it tangible, we speak to clients and they have those 360 roles, but still they need to do everything. The data management, ATS admin work, creating profiles for their clients, write-ups for to sell the candidate into the client. And it's all because it's so important. It's almost, you need to create this perfect formula to get to a placement and you cannot make too many mistakes in that formula. So they all give that responsibility to this one person who's responsible for the full cycle.
Yeah, no, you're right. It's because maybe tasks are not complex to execute, but that doesn't make them less important, right? Because if you don't do them, you won't get to the placement. If you don't fill in all these nitty gritty data details in the ATS, you don't get your talent pool. You don't know what's going on. You don't have status updates.
Yeah. So
it is really important. But then the question is, because we have the opportunity right now, who should do it?
Yep. And but it's almost a matter of who dares to do it, right? Because I think if you look at the best people will be very comfortable to give this to AI because they understand where they make the difference.
Yeah. So if, as a recruiter, you make the difference in parts that only humans can do, then you won't be scared.
No.
But if you are a recruiter and actually you are pretty comfortable behind your keyboard and actually you're not so comfortable selling a job, yeah, then maybe you're not so eager to delegate those tasks, not because it's technically not possible, not because, for example, AI can't do a better job than you, but just because it gives you a reason to come to work. So
yep. Yeah,
that is a reality. I mean, I don't know, that was maybe also the case with salespeople, right? In when you segmented those tasks.
Yeah, I think the difference is that if you look at a traditional SDR AE setup, it's still a colleague where you can talk to, where you maybe sometimes you sit next to, and that almost feels like you still have control. And obviously, when you are sleeping as a recruiter and your AI assistant is reaching out to your talent pool, engaging with candidates, maybe you woke up and it actually spoke to 50 of your potential candidates in your talent pool, and you wake up and you say, hey, these five are actually ready to talk to you, it feels like, oh, I don't have control, while this whole recruiter reality is about controlling a process. That's also why great recruiters are actually comfortable and good. That's the difference, yeah. I guess.
But then on the other hand, also with AI, there are methodologies to give that control back. It's not that you have to wake up in the morning and think, ooh, yeah. You know, yeah. 50 people in my yeah. calendar. There is a reason AI did that process. And you can also tell your AI colleague how to do it.
Yeah.
But I think the control you're losing... Sorry?
Can you give an example of that? How you can actually bring that feeling of control or insight to the recruiter?
I think with AI, it's really well to give perfect instructions. So you give this example. I wake up in the morning and the AI scheduled these interviews with candidates. But on the forehand, you can explicitly explain what is a good candidate. You can tell, in my calendar, I only do interviews between 9 and 12. And if you give those terms and conditions, if you share that on forehand, AI will listen better than a colleague.
Yeah, I understand. But I think it's more about, do you have control over what is discussed? What was the engagement? What was the first response of the candidate? What do I pick? What do I know? What do I pick up as a recruiter that I want to know to actually take the next step in the process? So I think it's also very important to have create this transparency on the communication between AI and candidates the recruiter itself is not doing it.
Totally. No, and that's, again, on forehand giving instructions and after the fact get summaries of what the AI recruiter did, or actually, you know, literally look in the conversation that the AI recruiter had. And I think in that reality, AI is more transparent than humans, because we all handed over tasks to colleagues and thought, okay, but what actually happened? Why didn't this deal close?
Yeah. So if you zoom out, I think on the long term, I'm not going to mention a time frame now because we don't know, but it would mean that we have, if you look at agencies, we will have big agencies like Randstad, new Randstads maybe even being built fully AI augmented teams with probably 20-30% of the people that can recruit against 50% of the cost, and they can do that all over the world without having 50 offices.
I think this, in history, this happened thousands of times in all industries when improving factories, when improving agriculture. And now, because of AI, it's time for knowledge workers to experience the same. And I'm convinced that the new manpower, the new Randstad, either, you know, they're going to innovate and they're going to grow even bigger, or someone new will pop up and take over that position.
Yeah, I fully agree. So four
years from now, that company is there.
Yeah?
Yeah.
As a market leader?
4 years from now, we have seen IPOs of companies in recruitment space that are AI and technology led and human enabled, and not the other way around.
Yeah. Well, I'll talk to you in 4 years then. Huh?
Cool.
And you ring the bell.
2028.
Okay, Baron, thanks.